Okay, so our next speaker is Amit Kulshrest, and he's going to give two lectures on images about maps and its relation with chirality. Amit?
Yeah, thank you, Anupam and Sripad, for the invitation. So I'll be speaking, as Anupam mentioned, Images of World Maps, that's the title, and Chirality. So what we'll do is that we'll try to understand what kind of subsets occur as images, and it was already there in Anupam's lecture. So it said that these are automorphism-invariant subsets, right? But are all of them realizable? That's the point. So there's a theorem of Lebotsky that is going to be the focus of my first lecture today. And then in the next lecture, next week, I'll talk about chirality. So that's also an interesting topic. So for today's lecture, the reference is Lebotsky's paper. So this is Alexander Lebotsky. And this is, I think S is not there. This is not there. The Glasgow Journal. 2014. That is the basic reference. It's a very short paper, very nice one. And it's independently readable. So I'll give a detailed proof of the main result there. And next time, it will be more like a survey talk for the chirality part. So part of this lecture I already gave in Pune, but here I think audience is quite different. So, okay. So basics were already covered in Anupam's lecture, where FD was a free group, right? That's a collection of words. Free group on, say, D many letters, X1, X2, XD. And a word is something that is an element of the free group. So it looks like something like, say, XI1, N1, XI2, N2, where all these XIs are coming from, those symbols on which we have free group. So XI, say, D, ND. So this is a word. So of course, each NI is an integer, could be positive or negative. And each XI subscript J is one of these letters on which free group is being considered. Yeah. So that's a word. And if you have a group, so we have corresponding.
Sir, maybe you want some other D there, like, because FD, you already have D in the FD.
The same D, no?
No, but if
Yeah,
it is
this
not.
ID, yeah, this definition of word, there is an ID appearing that D is not same as
Oh,
that.
I see, I see, I see. Got it, got it.
But
This D.
if you are allowing NI to be zero also, then maybe it's 10 manager. No,
No, it's
but
okay.
it may be like
I'll just
X2,
wait.
X1, X2, X1, X2 infinitely when it.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's okay.
That's
NR,
okay.
up to NR I am putting. Yeah?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Something. Yeah, so this D is okay. I thought that this D and this D. No, you're saying about R. So we have corresponding word map. Thanks, Sumit. So you have D many copies. And you evaluate. And you get an element in G. So evaluation is straightforward as per the group operation. And the notation is, WG. So WG is the notation for the image of W. So G is some group, of course. Okay. Yeah, so as Anupam mentioned, it's not the group generated by it, but it's just a set. The set. Sometimes it creates confusion, particularly when we are talking about commutators. And examples, of course, we have seen enough examples in tutorial itself. And two, in a sense, extreme ones were power maps and commutator maps. In today's lecture, some more examples of words will appear, but they will be very implicit. Even determination of how long they are is not going to be possible. In fact, some kind of optimization in certain sense is going to be an open problem. I'll make sense of that as we progress. Okay, so that's an image, WG. Mm-hmm. Oh, maybe I should change it. Ground. Yeah. Okay, so what do we observe here? It's a direct observation. This is about the image. So we are going to focus on the image sets. Anupam had mentioned last time some problems which concern the size of WG, size of this set. We are not concerned in this lecture on that, but on kind of structure of WG. So identity element of the group is always in the image, because you have the choice of throwing in 1, 1, 1 for all the variable values, and that's how you can get WG. And second is that it is actually union of conjugacy classes. Not only that, it's something more actually, right? And that was also discussed in the tutorial. In fact, much more generally, this is odd gene variant. Odd gene variant subset. Yeah, because that's again very straightforward. Because if you take any automorphism and suppose you have an element in the image, then an element in the image is going to look like gi1, n1, gi2, n2, and so on, gir, nr, and phi of that is of course going to be according to the same thing, same sequence of composing things. So gi1, n1 and so on, phi g I r n r, right? So it's very clear that it is the odd gene variant. So that is much more than saying that it's a union of conjugacy classes. Now the point is, the question which was asked by a couple of people, these are Kasabov, Nikolov and Shalev. The question was that if there is a subset of G that satisfies all these conditions, is it necessarily going to be image for a suitable word? And the question was asked in the particular context of finite simple groups. So I'm going to exhibit the positive answer of this. And the work is, as I mentioned, it's Libotsky's work. So this question is, Kasabov Nikolov and Shalev, and this is, as Libotsky mentioned, it was asked in a conference. So conferences are useful. Words and growth conference. This is 2012, Jerusalem 2012. So the question is, take a subset and where G is a finite simple group. And if identity element is there in A, and A is odd G invariant, then is it true that A is actually WG for a suitable word? Yeah. And they did not mention any D, but in fact, what Libotsky said is that even for D is equal to 2, there is example. Well, it is the affirmative answer. Oh, it's always. Okay, so answer is, yes, and that's what I'll justify, which is Libotsky's work for D is equal to 2 itself.
Amit, the question is equality or contained in that?
Equality.
Equality, okay.
Equality, yeah. So here, I want it to be equal.
I see.
Yeah. So each odd invariant subset containing identity, mm-hmm. is it realizable as word image for suitable word? And Libotsky says yes for finite simple groups, and mm-hmm. words are in two variables.
I see.
But the interesting thing is the words which will appear, they are too long and they are very implicit.
I see.
So existence is what is being proved in this lecture following this work of Libotsky. So I guess I have been able to state the problem.
So this is...
Sir, is it direct that odd-G invariant subsets are a union of conjugacy classes?
Yeah, because one of the automorphisms is inner automorphism, right? So you consider all inner automorphisms. You consider inner automorphisms.
Okay.
So what I mentioned here, in a sense, yes, 2 is redundant, but it's always good to see it as union of conjugacy classes, right? And it's just to say it. Okay. So there is some preparation for that. And
so just a general question. So this is for finite simple groups.
Finite simple groups, okay. Yes. And in fact, there are some more examples where some more groups were taken into account. So quasi-simple groups and all that. For them also, I guess subsequent work was done, and it's there. But on the other hand, if you think of other class of groups, so in a work in progress with Dilpreet and Harish, we have examples of groups where such statement does not hold in the extreme sense, actually. So we have situations of the extreme type, other type, where we show that most of the A will not be word images. Most of the images and the most also goes to like almost one, the entirety. So those kind of things may happen. So if you don't assume finite simple groups, things will be very different.
Okay.
Yeah, so maybe if there is time, I'll talk about what work is there in progress. Yeah, so I guess the problem...
I just want to make a trivial comment, as Manish sir pointed out, that containment is always there if you choose the trivial words, right?
Yeah.
So it's about equality.
Yeah, it's about equality. Yeah. Good. Thanks, Harish. Okay, so now let's go, let's see what kind of properties of finite simple groups go into this. And the crucial property which is going to be used is what some of you might be knowing, and I'll make a recall of that, which is called two generation of finite simple groups. So I'll just recall a couple of things about what is two generation of finite simple groups, because some people may get interested into this part itself from the word map discussion. So there are two references which I would like to mention here. One is an article by Shalev, and this is in Notices of AMS. And that is in 2001. I think it's called Asymptotics of Group Theory, or Asymptotic Group Theory. Some asymptotic word is there. And another very nice survey is much recent. This is Anupam and Yash Arora, a master's student with Anupam. This is 2020. I think it's available on archive, right? And
yes.
Is there in Math Consortium, right?
It's also available on their webpage.
Oh, it's also there on their webpage. Okay, so these are excellent articles for this. Anupam's one is more recent, so it contains much recent results. Okay, so what kind of results are there in these, which are going to help us in proving the theorem of Lvovsky, which is precisely the affirmative answer to the question that I asked. Okay, so this theorem, so I'm just presenting these things as theorem, although they are works across decades of different people. So this theorem, let me start with, I think this is called Brahana. This is like 1930s. And Albert Thompson. And that is like 1960s or something. And then maybe Steinberg, 1962. And I think then there are many people. I'll just. So it simply says that finite simple groups are two generated. That is, if G is a finite simple group, a I hope handwriting is readable. Then there exist A, B in G such that G is generated by A and B. It's not the inner product, this is generated by A and B. Yeah, maybe better notation would be I put A and B set and group generated. Yeah, so they're two generated, and that there's a like case by case work, as is always the situation for finite simple groups. We will be using something much stronger than two generation actually. So, and I come to that. So this is something called Dixon conjecture. This is 1969. And maybe it can be called theorem due to Dixon, and again across like years, Dixon 1969, Cantor, Lubotsky, Shalev, 1995. Maybe if I'm not missing people. So what it says is that you take two randomly chosen elements in finite simple groups. So if G is a finite simple group, and then you don't really have to work too hard to find these two elements. You randomly choose them essentially. It's a crazy statement. Two randomly chosen elements of G generate G. With probability tending to one as group size increases. Yeah, so this is just for some kind of fun. And in fact, they construct zeta functions corresponding to groups. So I'm not going into that, but there is an exciting theory where one can study all this. As Shalev said, it's asymptotic group theory. Yeah, this paper. And there's some complex analysis involved, for example, zeta function and all that. So in fact, something more is true, I should say. And that is Liebig and Shalev. So there's something called 2-3 generation, and I'll just explain it. So what is true is P23G, the probability of 2-3 generation also goes to 1. And what is 2-3 generation? So 2-3 generation meaning among these two elements, one of the elements is of order 2, another element is of order 3. So this also goes to 1 as size of G increases. But there is some exception. One group is exception, provided G is different from projective SP4 Q. So for this, as Q increases, there are some issues, but otherwise it's okay. So 2-3 generation, as I was mentioning, is G is generated by AB.
You meant to say G is not SP4.
Oh, G is not. Oh, yeah. The exception case. Thank you, Anupam. So order of A is 2. Order of B is 3. Yeah. So even 2-3 generation probability goes to 1. So in particular, there are elements for finite simple groups where 2-3 generation happens always. Okay. So
So for G equal to SP4Q, it works, is it?
No, we are for finite simple groups. So here finite simple is not algebraic.
The finite group sense. Okay. Thanks.
Yeah. So next one is what is called 3/2 generation, and I will actually be using this. So 3/2 generation, this is Guralnik, I think just 1K, and Cantor. Cantor or Cantor, I don't know how to pronounce. This is in 2000. And the statement is, it's much more than 2 generation. So you take randomly any element in G. So this is again for finite simple groups. Select A is G. Then you can always make this element a partner in generation. So then there exists B in G such that G is AB. So any randomly chosen element is always eligible to participate in 2 generation. This is what is called 3/2 generation. So I will actually be using this result. But other things I mentioned because someone may find interest in these kind of things and may read those articles which I mentioned. Yeah. So
why 3 and 2? You want order of A is also...
No. Order of A, no, that is okay. But 3/2 meaning it's less than...
Oh, okay. One you can fix and other...
Yes, A is randomly chosen.
In that sense, right.
A is randomly chosen. So he wants to say it's much stronger than 2 generation.
Right.
So it's like, of course, 1 generation cannot happen. So somewhere in between, it's 1.5 generation. Like we used to have those P3.5 property in topology. Okay. What else? I think, yeah, from this side, I'm done. So some more preparation. So that was one ingredient, 3/2 generation for finite simple groups. Okay. First remark is that for our purpose, we may assume that G is non-abelian. Else, you are in a situation where G is precisely Z mod PZ. And in that case, there is nothing much because A would either be identity or A would be equal to G. There is no other automorphism invariant set, right? P is prime. So we can assume that G is non-abelian, finite simple group. Okay. So I'm setting some stage. So it involves some somewhat lot of notation, but let's see. First thing that I'm taking is you just consider all possible elements, all possible AI, BI in G cross G, all possible elements. So maybe I should write it the way n is less than equal to I is less than equal to this. So this is just a way to write G cross G. Okay, I'm just enumerating them, AI, BI. So all possible pairs of elements in G cross G is being taken, and the enumeration is done with the purpose, and that purpose is actually, it's very smart enumeration. So enumerate it in a way that, so that for first L many pairs, the first L many pairs are such that AI BI generate the G. Last pairs mod G square minus L are those for which this does not happen. So enumerate it so that for some L, so of course L is lying between cardinal T square, we have that G is actually generated by AIBI if I is less than L, and otherwise it is a strict, it's a proper subset. So I'm just filtering out, I'm just first giving preference to those which actually generate G. Yeah, so that is first thing which I would like you to consider in mind. And second thing is that we can use these AIs, BIs to consider many homomorphisms. So for each I in 1, 2, up to cardinal T G square, you define this homomorphism from F2 to G, and this homomorphism is being called phi I. And what would it do? Given a word, you evaluate it. Well, you evaluate on it the ith pair AI BI. So WAI BI. So of course the word X will go to AI, or maybe X1 will go to AI, and X2 will go to BI under the influence of phi I. Yeah, so define this as a homomorphism. So you complete it to homomorphism, keeping in mind that the evaluation on AI BI is to be done. So this is ith evaluation map, ith evaluation homomorphism is what I have defined here. I guess
So there is a power cut here, so maybe that's why he is facing network issues. Hello.
So Amit had a power cut, so you'll have to wait for a couple of minutes before he moves to other computers.
Anupam, can
Yes, we can all
ask
discuss among ourselves till then.
questions? No, so for this finite groups of Lie type, like he was talking about PSP4, so it's not true. So, but it's obviously false, perhaps for if you allow center to be there, huh? I mean, even for without center, it is false. So it must
Yeah.
be. And this.
But probably which are with the groups which are very close to being simple, there won't be too many subsets left, if at all. I think the extremes will arise from some very different kind of groups, like solvable or something like that.
And Lubotsky's theorem is also false for non-simple groups.
Right, yeah. Amit, we can't
Amit,
hear you. Audio is off, probably.
Yeah, unmute
Yeah.
yourself, Amit sir.
Yeah,
Yes. Now is it okay? Sorry, there was a disconnection of internet here. So I was arranging other computer, but then this also got screen is not shared right now, right? So
No.
yeah, present now.
You
Okay.
can share it again. Yeah.
Yeah. We can see all this.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So I'm just defining, I'm just taking first those elements, those pairs, AI, BI, for which the property that AI, BI generate G holds. And after that, I'm considering the ones for which it does not hold. And I make use of evaluation on these AIs and BIs to define homomorphisms, which are named phi I. Yeah. So I guess that is clear. So here is a very immediate observation. So observation is that these homomorphisms, phi I, so phi A is surjective. If and only if, of course, I is less than equal to L, right? That is the meaning of generation. And few more things in the setup. So if I take automorphisms of G, and if I consider all these homomorphisms which have been defined, so phi I such that 1 is less than equal to I, these are square many size of G square. So these automorphism they act on this set, and the action is that if you have an automorphism and you have a homomorphism phi I, so the automorphism of G, and the homomorphism phi I from free group on two generators to G. So that is simply the composition map. Yeah, because F2 2G is phi I, and this is automorphism, so that's alpha. So this composition is simply the action. And so this action preserves phi I such that 1 less than equal to I less than equal to L. So first L first L homomorphisms are preserved under this action because it generates, that's all, right? So AI comma BI is generated, and the things which generate, they cannot go to the things which do not generate the group, right? So that's why this subset is preserved under this action. And
can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Why is this statement? So Amit made the statement. I mean, by the time Amit joins, I can clear out my. So he said phi I is surjective if and only if I is less than equal to L. Right? So,
no, he had just ordered it in that way.
But this, I mean, it has a W in it, right? So when he ordered, that means what did it mean? I mean, when he ordered, there were AIs, BIs had nothing about W, right? The word was not defined there. So now what is, am I missing something?
Let me just check.
He's mapping the word to its evolution at AI, BI.
Yes, so I agree with one way, right? That if PI is a surjective, then I is less than equal to L. But why, if I is less than equal to L, then PI is surjective?
So if I is less than L, then this pairs AI is BI generates G. So any element of G can be written as some powers of product of powers of the AI is BI.
That's
so you will get the corresponding word W such that your generator X1 is mapped to AI and the generator X2 is mapped to BI. Is it clarifies you?
Oh, so now the point is that there exists a word in which...
Right.
Is that okay? Okay. So the word is not fixed now when he's defining PIs. He's defining all words. Is that
yeah. Okay? So it is from F2. Yes. The map is from F2. All words.
All words.
So G.
Yes.
Okay.
And also, I think before that also I have a question. Why did he have this AI BIs? I mean, this means the number of such pairs is like L square, right? I mean, the set of AI BI such that this pair generates G is the total number is L square. Why? I mean, I think I'm confused at that
point. Order of G square, it will be.
It's
L is the number. Means,
L is between 1 to G square.
Yes.
Yeah. Says, and he has taken all the AI BI says that all the pairs which generate G.
Yes.
So if the number of those pairs is L, so he has taken, he has arranged them in first. I think he has been there at first.
So all those pairs we generate, you just write them in the beginning first. They are up to L. And after L, the other pairs you write, which do not generate.
Okay, okay. Now, okay, I know. I see. Okay, sure.
I mean, just for convention.
Sure. Yeah, this is only L in number, right? Some L is some number.
Yeah.
Thanks.
And for finite simple group, it will be guaranteed that this L is at least one.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, sir. I have also one doubt. Like,
yes,
let G be finite simple group. Yeah, let G be finite simple group. And if we choose a non-trivial element A in G, then can we find B always with respect to that A, so that A comma B is generated by A comma B generates whole G?
Yeah,
That was the 3/2 generation.
Okay.
That was the theorem he mentioned, which we call 3/2 generation. Due to Guralnik and Cantor. Yes, you can do that.
Yeah, I'm back actually. So there is a lot of fluctuation, unfortunately. Can you hear?
Yes, yes, Amit.
Okay, so this is another device with other internet. And it's another document which I have to know, the other journal document, because that's on the other computer. Yeah, I'll just continue from the previous thing. Yeah. So sorry about this. So what I was mentioning was this set which was there, which contained AI, BI. This is a very different one. And these are I think this is not really working properly. And first L are the ones. Which correspond to the generation. G is generated by AI, BI, and we have these homomorphisms phi I, which are defined from F2 to G, and this is evaluation on so any word going to evaluation on the ith is the screen visible?
Yes, yes, yeah.
Yeah, but the interface is very poor in this. This is the Mac one. Okay, yeah. And the second thing which I was mentioning was that ought G. So I'll write everything in the good handwriting and share with everyone. Ought G acts on this set of phi i's. Yeah, and not only that, there is something more, namely, it preserves. So this is action, which is given by just the composition. The action is just and it preserves first L elements. The set of first L elements. Because a pair which generates cannot go to the pair which does not generate under the influence of this action. And the action is free. That means alpha composed with phi I is equal to phi I. If so, there is no stabilizer, right? So alpha composed with phi I is equal to phi I implies alpha is one. Alpha is identity. Okay. And one can count number of orbits. That's very straightforward. But this is an action, it's a finite set. And of course, you can use, for example, Burnside's lemma or anything for counting orbits. So number of orbits, number of action, the number of not action orbit. For G action on the first L elements. I such that I is less than or equal to L. So for first L element, if you count the orbits, what you have is, this is, that would be L divided by size of the automorphism group. That is straightforward. Actually, you can use Burnside lemma if you want. So these many orbits are there. Yeah. So there are some more notations before we actually talk about proof in detail. So notation is that now I consider all automorphisms. So I have taken phi one, phi two, like that, phi of everything. So mod G square and I'm audible now?
Yes, Amir.
Oh, okay. So I thought that I have lost myself. Okay.
That's fine.
So this, and I define from F2, I take all possibilities. So I'm doing very nice account keeping. And F2 to this group, which is a direct product of these many copies of G, I define a grand homomorphism phi. Lebowski denotes it by phi m. So phi m takes care of all the homomorphism. So a given word goes to the respective evaluations on all those possible pairs. So phi 1w, phi 2w, like that. Phi mod g square w. Yeah, if the net comes in the other thing, then I'll connect from that. Yeah, actually net is back in the other one, so I'll just connect and pump from the other one, huh?
Sure, yeah.
You can hear me, right?
Yes, yes.
Nice.
Now we can't hear you.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'll go back to the original thing. You can see?
Yes.
Oh, nice. So this is what happened when I went to the other device, when I got disconnected. So, but anyway, so what we are having here is, a homomorphism, which is bunch of everything. F2 to G mod G square, a word is evaluated on all possible pairs. So all possible pair that was phi I, sorry, phi 1, W, phi 2, W, like that. Phi, these many were there. Yeah, this was there, right? And of course, phi I, W was, W being evaluated on ith pair, yeah. And so this is one ingredient in the discussion. Other ingredient which we will be focusing on is kernel of this, kernel of phi m. So what is a kernel? So kernel is precisely words for which the image is trivial, right? So words for which the image is trivial, they will be in the kernel. So this is some interesting way of organizing your data. Ni is going to denote the kernel of phi I. So phi I is from F2 to G, and the kernel of that is Ni, and so therefore M is intersection of all these kernels. So M is intersection of all Ni's. I is from 1 to mod g square, that is M, and I identify inside this M intersection corresponding to the first L kernels. So intersection is from I to L, N I, and this is what is denoted by N. So this is the kernel, the intersection of kernels corresponding to the generating part, those pairs AIBI, which generate the group G.
Amit, the inclusion is the other way around, right?
Yes, yes. It should be other way.
Sorry. Yeah. So N is another thing. And another part of notation is that since I will be distinguishing the first components, first L components and last components beyond L, so I'll be considering some projection maps later on. So this part, the first L is called E, the last L is called D. So this is the target of the epimorphisms, right? Phi i's, phi i's which are epimorphisms, and this is target of remaining homomorphisms.
Yeah, Amit, we lost you in between again.
Anupam sir, can I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
So, by what W means an element of pre group of rank D?
Sorry?
By what W in D letters, we mean an element of pre group of rank D? Okay.
There is no D in picture. We are all taking everything on F2. We are assuming two generation.
No, I'm not asking about this simple groups only. I'm asking in general.
Oh, okay. Oh, you are asking some general question.
Yeah. So what W means in D letters means an element of three group on rank D.
And but there is this general theorem, right? That free group on D generate free group of two generator contains free group on.
Yeah. So that was edited my question. So, are both the image same?
No, because I mean, I don't know whether you can precisely say that. We'll have to look at what kind of proofs are there for that. But
So what is the
they are with respect to different generators anyway?
Yeah, but so
what is the question?
The question is a free group on two generator contains free group on D generator, but. Okay. Given a word on degenerator, how do you see this exactly as a
so you can write that as element of two generator,
but the I mean variables are different in two
places. Variables are different. So question is that are both the images are same or not?
Okay,
yeah, it does appear like that.
Yeah.
Yes,
I would also say so.
If I understand Tushar's question, he's asking that if the result is true for FD, you have a word in D generators, but then that can be seen as a subset of F2, and so you have a result for 2. Yes, that is true.
Is it true for in general, say in general groups?
Your connection is cutting in between. Do you want to write it in the chat box?
Okay.
You are muted. Amit, you are muted.
Yeah, I was just sharing the...
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. You can see the screen?
Yes.
So here, rather, I would be using the scanned version because on this computer, it doesn't seem that I can write properly. Yeah?
Okay. Yeah.
So though all those homomorphisms were there, I had defined the kernel of the grand homomorphism, which is phi m. And the kernel is the collection of all those words for which the word image is trivial. And ni was defined to be the kernel of phi I. And these subsets, these subgroups were also defined. You take the intersection of all the kernels, that was called M. So M is precisely kernel of phi M, so that is there. And you consider intersection of those kernels for which the first generating part, the first L many. So that generating thing you do, and it's clear that F2 mod Ni, so F2 mod the kernel is isomorphic to G if and only if the I is corresponding to the generating part. So I is less than or equal to L. And we are dividing it into two parts. I'll just put it. I'll just make it writable. So I'll just put this. Yeah. Yeah. So the first L, that is D, E, and the last, that is D. And what is being done is that we are considering now projection maps, projection onto E and projection onto D. So E is the epimorphism part, D is rest of the part, and here I think I also defined this H, which is just the image. Okay, so I have not defined. So H is the image of phi m. H is the image of phi m. Huh, so here it is, yeah. So H is the image of phi m, and it is a structure of H. The structure of H that is going to play a crucial role in our discussion. So H is kind of database of all the images. So we consider the projections of this H on the epimorphism part as well as the non-epimorphism part. And the respective kernels are denoted K and L. Those are kernels for the epimorphism part and the non-epimorphism part for the image. So from image to D prime and image to E prime. So E prime is just the image under projection map. So so basically it's about understanding the structure and how it splits into E cross D part. So maybe I'll just give a summary of it quickly. So this this is the summary of the discussion, which maybe we can in the tutorial understand it better. So first is H is actually E prime cross D prime. So those projections, H is actually the direct product of those two projections on the epimorphism and non-epimorphism part. And the epimorphism part is actually R prime, is a certain number of copies of R, a certain number of copies of G. And there is some argument which I am skipping here, which says that this argument is due to Cantor-Lebowski in some earlier work, which says that in such a situation, this R prime is actually equal to R. what is R? R is the number of orbits of the odd G action on phi I's, phi one, phi two, up to phi L. So that the R prime is same R. So what is the summary of all this discussion? So summary would be in this observation that, and this observation recognizes when is an element when is an element there in E prime. So it characterizes all the elements of E prime. So what are those elements? So this is some kind of coherent. This U1, U2, there is some kind of coherence. What coherence is there? See, if phi I and phi j, they are in the same alpha orbit, same odd g orbit with respect to alpha. So alpha takes phi I to phi j, then the same kind of relationship must hold on uis. And those coherent, that coherent sequence of uis is what is going to be there in e prime. So then we must have alpha ui is uj. So some kind of coherence is there. Yeah. So there is a justification. Maybe in the tutorial part again we can see the justification of that. It is quite straightforward. Let me come to the main part after introducing the all this notation. But anyway, yeah, this thing is what one may remember. So one may remember that image of H. What was H? H is was the image of the grand homomorphism, that phi M, right? Now, under E cross D, that decomposition, the image of H was E prime. And what all the discussion which we did just now summarizes to is that E prime is a subgroup of GL, the epimorphism part. And the subgroup is isomorphic to GR, where R is orbits. And the size of R is actually L divided by size of automorphism group of G. So it's isomorphic to GL, and this is embedded in GL by a certain twist. Certain twist is there through the action in which E prime is sitting inside GL. So it's not as such diagonal, but some kind of twist is there. Anyway, so far this was kind of collecting all the information, and now we can come to the proof part of this. So we start with A, which is invariant under odd G, and identity also belongs to A. So that is our group, that is our set A. And first I remove identity from it. Identity is removed and A prime is there. So A prime is a union of orbits of this, right? So it's that's what is given to us. Now, what we claim to start with is that the number of orbits which are there is less than equal to R. So this is union of orbits, right? So how many orbits are there in this action? So what we are saying is that this number of orbits is less than R, which is L divided by odd G, which was number of orbits for the odd G action on phi 1, phi 2, phi L. So to see this, the way one should argue is this. So if you pick an element of A, minus 1. So if you pick an element, that gives rise to a homomorphism. Why? Because this A can be involved in a generating set. Right, that's what 3/2 generation was. So it is involved in some generating set AIBI. That means there exists one index between 1 and L such that AI is A and BI is some other thing, and AB generate. So generate meaning it is I is less than equal to L. So A can be forced to generate the group 3/2 generation, and therefore corresponding phi I can be considered. And in place of A, if I take some other element in the orbit of A, then the automorphism to be considered is alpha composed with phi I. So it is going orbit wise. That means one orbit here, one orbit of the action of odd G on G, right? So one orbit here is able to detect at least one orbit of odd G action in phi I. In some cases, what may happen is that it may be able to detect two, because there could be various choices of AI. Yeah, so there could be two different possibilities, namely for the same A. Yeah, that's the point. So for the same A, there might be two different Bs, which are different, and maybe they are not even in the same orbit. So such that G is generated by AB as well as AB prime. Okay, so you can just use an argument based on this to conclude that the number of orbits of odd G action on A prime is less than equal to number of orbits of odd G action on phi 1, phi 2, phi L. Yeah. Okay, so now the final part comes. So what we do is we consider
Amit, so in the probe, the L was the order of G, right?
Yeah. No, L is not the order of G. No.
No, okay.
So L is all possible, the count of pairs AI, BI such that AI and BI generate G.
Okay, so that's
so that all possible nothing. Two size sets which generate G.
Okay, yeah.
So L is count of that. And since some orbit considerations can be done, because whatever is the corresponding automorphism, whatever is the corresponding homomorphism from F2 to G. So on that set, odd G operates, or odd G does action, and number of orbits is R. So R is L divided by size of the automorphism group. And number of orbits of odd G action on A prime except identity, that is less than equal to R. This is what we have argued. And now we are in the last part of the proof. So what we do is we consider one particular element Z bar in the large group, the E cross D, which is mod G square many copies of G. And how do we define it? So ith coordinate of Z bar is AI if I is less than equal to L and AI belongs to A prime. So A prime was arbitrary subset which was odd invariant and which was containing identity. So this is taking care of epimorphism part. So Zi is AI if I is less than equal to L and AI is in A prime, and it is one otherwise. And then there is some argument which says that this Z prime which we have picked is in H. What is H? H is the grand homomorphism, the image of that. Okay, so Z, the element which we have chosen is actually in the grand image of F2, and then phi m F2. And there is some argument which goes, maybe I'll not go much in detail. So because there was a criteria that just now I had shown, which said that when is an element in E prime. So using that criteria, you can actually determine that Z bar is actually in H. So it's straightforward, nothing difficult at all. Okay, so yeah. So once I show that Z bar is in H and H is phi m F2. So that means it is image of some word W. So there exists some W in F2 such that phi m W is Z prime. So Z prime this is a Z bar. The Z bar was constructed using A, whatever A was given to us, odd invariant subset. So what's the meaning of this? Phi m w is Z bar. So I take ith coordinate. So ith coordinate is phi I w. On the other hand, for this, the ith coordinate is Z I. And w a I b I is Z I. And Z I, as I vary I, so I am varying I across all possible mod g square many things. So if I vary I, what I get on one side is the image of G. So as I vary AI and BI for all possible values, I get WG. So I am varying over all possible mod G square pairs. And from the other side, what I get is ZI as I is varying from 1 to G square. So for the non-epimorphism part, ZI was 1. So I won't be getting anything, but for the epimorphism part, I'll precisely get A prime. And of course, identity is there. So what I get is that there exists one element which is in the image. There exists one word whose image is precisely A. Yeah. So just in the end, one can look at the proof again and conclude this. What's the conclusion? Is that if you have any finite simple group, then to that group, you can actually find a word such that if you evaluate it on some AB, then the evaluation is non-zero if and only if group generates G. So for finite simple group, whether a pair A comma B generates the group or not can be detected using a word. So that is something interesting. However, all this is existential and it's very difficult to actually construct such a word. So all this goes because we were able to prove certain criteria of when will something be in the image of the grand word, and we actually constructed something using A prime, which is there in the image of that grand homomorphism phi m. So yeah, that is what I wanted to say. I think the lecture has been very chaotic, but I will be happy to take questions. I can compensate for it.
Sure. Yeah. Any question people have?
Madhishi, did it make sense?
Of course. It's all words. No action.
What is this? Harish, you are saying G may not be generated by A and B. Meaning what?
Sir, I am just trying to answer Tushar's question. He has some question in the chat box.
I didn't see the question at all. Okay. I think a lot of discussion is happening. I see. Okay. Oh, okay. There is something. So, Tushar, what's your question?
So, sir, my first question is that every word in D letters can be identified as a word in two letters.
Okay.
So we have a map from D many copies of G to G, and we have a map from two copies of G to G.
Yeah.
The question is that are the image set under both the map are same or not?